So tonight the message is entitled, Isaac Speaks. And anybody who's a Bible student, anybody who's been around Christianity or Judaism, and other religions for that matter, are often going to hear these three names. Because these three names that I'm about to mention are the names of the patriarchs, the term that we use is the patriarchs, the three men, a father, a son, and a grandson. And these three patriarchs are the kind of like the bedrock of the faith. We hear the name mentioned in Jewish circles. We hear the names in the churches. Matter of fact, the Bible mentions them multiple times. And they each one have a special lesson to teach us. So I want to talk to you tonight about this. And I'm specifically going to focus on Isaac. But the three are Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Many times you'll see in the Bible the phrase, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Interestingly, they all three turned their hearts to Jehovah, Yahweh, to the true God. All three of them obeyed the Lord and obeyed God in various ways. Some of the three had a little tougher time getting where they needed to be with God than some of the others. It's interesting to see the difference in the personalities, even though they were related. And Abraham, of course, is called the father of faith, the father of our faith. He's the one who first received the covenant from God for the Jewish people. And obviously, by extension, he provided the Messiah, Jesus Christ, who was a Jew in his earthly form, to be the Savior of the world. So he brought salvation through the Jewish people, through the Jewish faith, through the Old Covenant. So the Old Covenant speaks to all of us in this age in which we live. But it's important for us to understand the flow of history. So that's why we revere Abraham and say he's the father of faith. Then we have his son, who was Isaac. And I'm going to talk about him in just a minute, but Isaac also had sons. And one of them was Jacob. Jacob. And Jacob was the father of the 12 tribes of Israel that we read about in the Old Testament. And the journeyings and the encampments and all those things. That was Father Jacob that brought that about. But then there's Isaac. He's the son of Abraham. And Isaac's an interesting figure. Interestingly, if you look in the Bible, he's not mentioned as much as Abraham. He's not mentioned as much as Jacob, but he's equally important and very pivotal for our faith. So if you look in the Old Testament, you'll find the name of Abraham 175 times. If you look in the New Testament, you'll find the name Abraham 75 times. If you look in the Old Testament for the name Jacob, you'll find it 349 times. If you look in the New Testament, only 27. But compared to those two, Isaac isn't mentioned nearly as much. In the Old Testament, he's mentioned only 108 times. And in the New Testament, only 20 times. But the fact is, he was so critical and pivotal in promoting God's plan in the earth that it's incredible. And Isaac, among the three, was the one who stands out as a type of Christ. A type meaning a figure or a shadowing. In other words, his life and what happened to him points us very graphically to Jesus and even describes in some ways the characteristics of the Messiah. And so Isaac really, really matters if you're a Christian. If you look at his story, you find out that he was born very, very late in Abraham and Sarah's life. And so when you talk about a miracle, you're talking about a serious miracle when you talk about Isaac. And he was the one who God promised he would bring the covenant through, that he would bring the blessing through. So Isaac is largely the reason why we had Jesus here on the earth and why he brought that New Testament, that new covenant for all of us. And if you remember the story, God told Abraham to sacrifice Isaac on Mount Moriah. What an amazing request, a crazy request. course, how many understand? Even things we don't understand, God has a reason for it. And so whenever they got ready to do this, and Isaac, being a young man at that time, came with his father to go and sacrifice to the Lord. And he came along not knowing that he was intended to be the sacrifice. And when they got to the place of the mount, some of you will remember the fact that they got all their materials together, and Abraham carried the fire and the knife for the sacrifice. But Isaac carried the wood on his back. He carried the wood up the hill. He carried the wood up the hill to the top where they built the altar of sacrifice. And you remember what happened. Isaac said, "Well, Father, where's the lamb for the sacrifice?" And Abraham said, "The Lord will provide." But Abraham had such an incredible faith, even believing that if he sacrificed his own son, that God could raise him from the dead. That's what the Bible says. That's how much faith this man had. Confidence in God. And so he tied him up and put him on the wood, preparing to do the sacrifice. But God provided, I believe it was a ram in the thicket. And the ram shook the thicket, and the angel of the Lord stopped his hand and said, "God indeed has provided a sacrifice." Now, how many understand that Jesus carried his cross up to the hill of Calvary? It's called Golgotha in the scripture. And he carried that wood on his back, taken up to the top of the hill to be sacrificed as the perfect sacrificial lamb of God. And he was the one who was being foreshadowed in that story. And it should move every Christian to realize that we have fouled up, messed up, sinned, and offended God. It's not real politically correct to say that these days. It's not popular to say it these days. There's a lot of churches, and there's certainly people in the secular world that kind of recoil when you start talking that way. But one of the greatest things you can do is just acknowledge that you are certainly not perfect, and nor am I. One of the greatest things you can do for yourself, one of the most freeing things you can do, is say, "Look, I've got some great goals in my life. I want to be a nice person. I want to be a kind person." That's well and good. But even with your best efforts, the scripture defines our righteousness as filthy rags. It's just not good enough. See, and so we've got to recognize we're serving God, and God is absolutely perfect in every way. And pride and arrogance and hatred and sin cannot exist in the presence of God. And so when we see that story of Isaac carrying the wood up, and we think about Jesus carrying the cross, next week we're going to be talking about the triumphal entry. And then we're going to be talking about the crucifixion. We're going to be talking about the resurrection. I'm excited about this service coming up for Resurrection Weekend. It's going to be great. I hope you invite some friends, invite some relatives. Come on, we're going to have some special music. It's going to be incredible. It's going to be wonderful. And we're going to celebrate. Why? Because we know that he's the sacrifice. We know that he's the substitute for our sins, what we've failed and where we've messed it up. God has provided a perfect sacrifice so that, you know what? We can come before him. I love that last song we sang. What a beautiful name it is. And the curtain that held us out of the holy place of God, when Jesus died on the cross, it ripped in two. It ripped from top to bottom. Why? Because God was signifying through the Spirit that we have entrance now into the presence of God. Why? We couldn't go in our own righteousness. But we could go because of his righteousness, which he puts upon us when we come to him. We say, "Yes, Jesus, yes, we love you." I hope everybody's getting this. Now, let's read a little bit of a story here. We're going to go to Genesis 26. I want to read a few verses for you. And I want to tell you this story so that we can draw some wonderful thoughts from it. We're going to start in the first verse of Genesis, the 26th chapter. I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation. Don't always use that, but it's a great translation, very good. And it's got some interesting insights that I want to bring to you. And here's what it says: "A severe famine now struck the land, as had happened before in Abraham's time. So Isaac moved to Gerar, where Abimelech, king of the Philistines, lived. The Lord appeared to Isaac and said, 'Do not go down to Egypt, but do as I tell you.'" Interesting phrase, very important. Verse 3, live here as a foreigner in this land. And I will be with you and bless you. Does anybody besides me want God to be with you and bless you? Am I the only one? What a beautiful thought. I hereby confirm that I will give you all these lands to you and your descendants, just as I solemnly promised Abraham your father. I will cause your descendants to become as numerous as the stars of the sky. And I will give them all these lands. And through your descendants, all nations of the earth will be blessed. That's ultimately pointing to Christ. Verse 5, I will do this because Abraham listened to me and obeyed all my requirements, commands, decrees, and instructions. So Isaac stayed in Gerar. When the men who lived there asked Isaac about his wife, Rebekah, he said, she is my sister. He was afraid to say, she is my wife. He thought, they will kill me to get her because she is so beautiful. But sometime later, Abimelech, king of the Philistines, looked out his window and saw Isaac caressing Rebekah. Immediately, Abimelech called for Isaac and exclaimed, she is obviously your wife. Why did you say she is my sister? And Isaac said this, because I was afraid someone would kill me to get her from me. Verse 10, how could you do this to us? Abimelech exclaimed. One of our people might easily have taken your wife and slept with her, and you would have made us guilty of great sin. Then Abimelech issued a public proclamation. Anyone who touches this man or his wife will be put to death. Look at this. When Isaac planted his crops that year, he harvested 100 times more grain than he planted, for the Lord blessed him. He became a very rich man, and his wealth continued to grow. He acquired so many flocks of sheep and goats, herds of cattle and servants, that the Philistines became jealous of him. How many would like to be so blessed that there's a whole bunch of people jealous about all your blessings? I think we ought to live that way. I don't think there's anything wrong. Now, I don't think we ought to flaunt the blessings of the Lord. But sometimes the blessings of the Lord are a little bit like salt. You know, you give people a little taste of the blessing of the Lord, and they get a little thirsty for righteousness, a little thirsty for the blessing of God. They start to realize there's a better way to live than a tired, dead way. How many found out there's a better way to live than a worn out, tired out, beat up, dead way of kind of meandering like a zombie through life? How many are with me? So I think we ought to live in such a way that people could become jealous. Now, I don't want to induce anybody into fleshly kind of attitudes. Jealousy is one of the works of the flesh. But you know, jealous people are going to be jealous, right? And so we live our lives with such joy. We live our lives with such peace. We live our lives in the name of Jesus, not because we're better than other people, but because he's better. Not because we're better than someone over there or someone over there or our relatives or neighbors. We live a joyful and a peaceful life because of his grace and power upon us. And you know what? Shame on us if we don't live up to that expectation. Why not walk in all that God has for you? And you know what? It also includes being blessed and prosperous. It really does. Prosperity might be defined differently here than some other places around the world. And there are some places where Christians are suffering greatly. But the ultimate goal of God is to bring prosperity into our lives and bless us. I can say that without equivocation from this pulpit as a minister of the gospel. We see that here. God said, I will bless you. And so how did he bless him? He blessed him with crops that were massive. He became a rich man. His wealth grew. He acquired sheep and goats, herds of cattle. So I'm not against prosperity in the gospel. But I would rather say that if I got to choose between having a big old bank account and having some peace in my life, I'm going to put the emphasis on the peace. And so we put the emphasis where it needs to be. And yet we recognize that God intends for us to be blessed. And whatever we put our hands to, the Bible says, will prosper. So I see that in this scripture. And I see it in Isaac's life. I don't know if you do. But I want to talk about some of these things because I want to talk about how the blessing came to this man. It's so unusual and yet so instructive. And I particularly took note of verse 12. We have this story going on here of all this drama. It sounds like something like The Young and the Beautiful. Did you notice that? Or what is it, Young and the Beautiful or The Old and the Restless? Young and the Restless. See, I'm not up on all my soap operas. I'm proud to say I've never seen a soap opera one episode all the way through. I'm proud to say that. And what was it, General Hospital? Is that still on? I don't know. That's the longest running one or something. You know, I know trivia, but I don't know anything about them. But this is almost like a soap opera. It's incredible. And you've got all this drama and all these machinations, everything going on here. And then all of a sudden, right in the middle, the 12th verse pops up and it says, when Isaac planted his crops that year, he harvested 100 times more grain than he planted, for the Lord blessed him. You see, the Lord blessed him. People say, well, I don't want to hear about prosperity. Well, prosperity is a part of the gospel. Abraham became rich. Jacob became rich. Isaac became rich. And there's blessings of all sorts. Some people don't have huge bank accounts, but yet they're prosperous because they have what they need. Prosperity is having what you need and maybe having enough to support the things of God and to be able to help others. It doesn't help you to be broke. If you're broke, so broke you can't help anybody else who's broke. Christians ought to be praying that God will pour out blessing. The Bible says, I wish above all things you would prosper and be in health. You say, well, Randy, what does that prosper mean? It means a lot of things. But it would include these kinds of blessings. God meeting your needs. Let's believe God for those things. And so I noticed this 12th verse because it seemed like such a, I almost got whiplash reading it. Because I'm coming along with the whole soap opera thing, you know, the whole melodrama, and then boom, we're into massive blessings. Here's a guy who obviously got some imperfections, just like his father and just like his son ultimately had, just like Abraham, just like Jacob, Isaac had these problems. And so, but it's interesting to see the road to the blessing that he received. You know why? Because it speaks to every one of us. I want to see if you can see yourself in this same journey that Isaac finds himself. It's interesting. The first thing we see is the Bible says there was a famine, a severe famine in the land. A severe famine. And a lot of times, blessings will start with a famine of some sort or a lack. Sometimes when you see lack in your life, you ought to have enough faith to recognize that's very often where God starts you to turn you toward the blessing. A lot of times when we feel like we don't have what we need or we're low on something, sometimes we recognize there's this hole in our life. Sometimes that's when we kind of get our attention on Him. We start to recognize, wait a minute, I got to get in a different path. I got to go a different way. And we start to walk that way toward the blessing of God. And even Christians, believers, many times we need this to shake us up a bit and say, you know what, if I got something going on in my life where there's a lack of something, I've got to take a close look at that and I've got to make the necessary adjustments in the Holy Spirit so that I can get on a path toward God's blessing in my life. And it's not just money. I mention money because that's such a controversial area, but it's also peace. It's also joy. How many have ever had somebody in your life, and maybe you've experienced, where you had a lack or a famine of peace? You had anxiety and you had tension in your life and you're turning over at night and wondering what's going to happen and you're wringing your hands. Oh, don't look at me so sanctimoniously. I've been there and so have you. So that's a famine. What about a famine of really, really healthy and rewarding relationships? There's many people in the world would give their left arm for a decent friend. Somebody they could count on, somebody that really cared about them. And in the church of Jesus Christ, we ought to be the best of friends. It doesn't mean we'll get along about everything. It doesn't mean we'll all agree on every little last point of whatever's going on, or certainly even doctrine. Sometimes we won't. But you know what? We know that we've got a common elder brother. His name is Jesus the Christ. And you know what? That makes us brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Come on. And so we have those famines in our life. One of them is a famine of money. A famine of money. Sometimes we just don't have enough money at the end of our bills. We get to the end of the month, we wonder how we're going to do this. Oh man, I've had that happen many times. Many, many times. And yet God was able to come through. God was able to make a difference. God was able to turn the tide. I love to tell the story about the time when we went for so many years making so little money that we didn't have to pay any income tax. Nothing. You know, now they actually send you money back, I think, if you're low enough. But we didn't pay anything in as far as what we owed. And so I'm thinking, okay, great. We were self-employed at that time. And we came along, and this one year, all of a sudden, we made a little more money. And we didn't pay quarterly because we didn't think we had to. But when we added it up at the year, at the end of the year, we realized we owed $800. Now, that may not sound like a lot of money to you guys, but boy, back then in the day, that was some serious buckaroonies. Come on, somebody, are you out there? I mean, that was like a lot. That was like you might as well win the lottery for us. You know what I'm saying? Come on, how many know Frank and Beans and Beans and Frank? Come on, you know, Frank's. We had three meals every, a lot of macaroni and cheese, and then on Thursdays we'd have cheese and macaroni. You know, you just switch it up a little bit. Oh, yeah, come on, somebody, you know what I'm talking about. And so we're thinking, man, and I got freaked out. Because, you know, you start messing with the IRS, you know, I get visions of me doing the perp walk. How many know what I'm talking about? You know, they're going to haul me out because I don't have the $800. You know, yeah, I don't look good in stripes. I'm much better in pastels and plain colors. But, you know, so at least, here's the thing I like that I emphasize. Maybe you can fit this into your own experience. I didn't keep a good attitude about this need. I had a famine of money, and I also had a famine of joy. Anybody ever hear somebody with a famine of joy? I had a famine of peace. Come on, somebody, right? But my wife, Lisa, God bless her, she kept a good attitude. She was the one who was kind of the rock through the whole thing. And I was like real grumpy, you know. I mean, when I went to church, I acted okay. Uh-oh. If you can't say amen, say ouch. Come on. I was fine at church. But every other time, I'm like snapping, I'm grumpy, I'm worried, I'm wringing my hands. How are we going to do this? Where are we going to get $800? We have no way to get it. Can't borrow it from anybody. Can't borrow it from a bank. Nobody's going to loan us money. What are we going to do? The IRS is coming. You know what I'm talking about. And so anyhow, Lisa said, well, we got to pray about this. She talked about prayer. She said, go ahead. Just go ahead. I'll pray, I guess, but, you know. Most of the time, she'd be praying, and I'd be watching reruns of Gilligan's Island. Is anybody out there tonight? And so she says, no, it's the truth. I was the leader of the praise team, too. Come on. You guys act so surprised. I don't think so. And so she kept praying, and I said, man, I don't know what we're going to do. I said, we're about like 3 days from when we've got to send the money in. 2 days, we're going to have to send the money in. I said, Lisa, what are we going to do? I'm complaining, I'm griping, I'm moaning to God, I'm moaning to her, I'm moaning to anybody I could talk to, including our dog, Tico. She says, well, let me get out the bank book again and go through it. She goes through it. We pull the kids' piggy banks. Sorry, Nate and Celeste. We pulled their piggy banks and emptied those out, and we got it all pulled together. And I think she said, I went through everything. She said, and it's not there. We don't have it. We got like $38.14. I said, okay, well, like I said, we're doomed. I might as well practice the perp walk. So anyhow, so we got down to the day of, honestly, the day of. And Lisa said, man, I don't know what we're going to do, but I'm praying. I believe God. We got to stay cheerful. We got to stay joyful. Yeah, I said, yeah, I understand. Go ahead. It's the truth. You want a pastor that's honest? Well, you got one. And so she says, I'm going to get out the bank statements one more time, and I'm going to look and see if maybe we can get $100 or buy them off for a while, or, you know, do whatever we need to do to try to hold this situation off. So she gets the bank statements out again, and I think I have this correct. And there was she got down to one of them there. Was it the last one in the month? The last month? Is that the way it was? Do you remember now? It was one of the recent bank statements. And all of a sudden, she realizes that the balance at the bottom, there's a deposit for $800 in the account. We didn't make that deposit. We absolutely didn't make that deposit. And nobody else had any access to our account, knew the numbers or anything. But there was $800 in the account, $800, which is what we needed for the IRS, and $38.17. And I said, how is that possible? She said, all things are possible through God. And I said, yes, I knew it all the time. I knew it. I knew God was going to meet the need. Hallelujah. I said, but we better call the bank. That looks like a mistake to me. We didn't put the money in there. Nobody. We didn't have any automatic transfers or anything. How did it get in there? We went to the bank and talked to the lady at the bank. She went through the records thoroughly. I says, I don't want. We have no idea where that came from. She says, I've checked this out. She said, Mr. Estelle, I don't know how it got there. Mrs. Estelle, I'm not sure what happened, but that money is in your account, and that money belongs to you. Have a nice day. I said, you too. God's been good to us. Love you. Praise the Lord. Do you know Jesus? Come on. Do you know Jesus? Come on. Let's pray. Come on. How many know what I'm saying? And so we wrote out the check, sent it to the IRS, took the $38.17 and went and got a spaghetti and meatball dinner with black olives, salad, and Pepsi. Come on, somebody. Come on. Hallelujah. Yeah, we were living high that week. See, you can have a famine in your life, but God's the only one that can meet the need in your life, no matter what it is. It could be finances, it could be joy, it could be peace, it could be a great relationship. It could be some kind of hope you need. Maybe you've lost hope. You might have a famine of hope. You see, Isaac started out in his journey toward great blessings with a famine. That's how it started. So if you're in a position tonight, listen to me, look at me, where you feel you got a famine in your life. Maybe your kids are away from the Lord, or maybe you've got some anxiety, or maybe you got a lack of health and you feel sick, or maybe you're not. Look, famines are God's specialty. He resolves them. He uses them to point us in the right direction. Those of you who agree with me, just say a good amen. Let's be a little bit Pentecostal. Say amen. I like that. And you'll notice that Isaac reacts to it. Did you notice that? It's a severe situation. It must be severe. Why? Because it says that he went into the land of Gerar, where Abimelech, the king of the Philistines, lived. If there's anybody in the Bible that wears a black hat, it's the Philistines. Goliath was a Philistine. The Philistines, they had wars with the Philistines constantly. The Philistines were a pain where a pill cannot reach. They created problems for them all the time. So you know it was a bad situation. If Isaac loads up and goes over there to hang out with Abimelech, it must be bad when you move in with your perennial enemies. It must be a bad day. Something's wrong going on. And so he reacts, and he's trying to resolve it. He's in trouble, and he's thinking, well, I'll go over there. At least maybe they have some stuff, and we can survive over there. And he goes over there. And don't you know, when he makes that move and he goes over there, God appears to him and says to him, do not go down to Egypt, but do as I tell you. See, we've got to keep our ear open for the Lord to speak to us. We've got to recognize that when we get into these famine situations, tough situations, God's very readily willing to step in and speak to us. I don't always understand everything that's going on, but how many have confidence that God does? How many have confidence that the Lord knows your tomorrows? He understands your situation now. He knows where you've come from. He's got the whole thing covered. And when I see that, where he says, do not go down to Egypt, that piqued my interest. I thought, wait a minute. Why would God say that? Why would he say, don't go down to Egypt? It must be some reason. I started looking back after studying this for 3 or 4 days to Abraham, his father, because the first verse says there was a famine that struck the land, as had happened before in Abraham's time. It's amazing how much of Isaac's life matched move for move with his father. How many know you can get in a groove with your family, right? Yes. Sometimes we do the good things our family have done, and sometimes we pick up on the bad things our family has done. Sometimes we get good things from our dad. Sometimes maybe we get a few bad habits. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying? And so we've got to be aware of that, and that's what happened here. You see, when Abraham, and I'm not going to say it was necessarily bad that he went down to Egypt, but Abraham, when the famine struck, moved to Egypt. And I got a feeling, because God addressed it, that Isaac was thinking about going to Egypt too. That's the way Dad handled this. My dad handled, let's go on down to Egypt. He's probably thinking about that. And God said, no, I want you to do what I tell you to do. See, what your dad did is not necessarily a word for you. What your mom did is not necessarily the way God wants to guide you. God wants every person here to get your own revelation of what God intends for your life. We're not going to just ride on the coattails, as we used to say, of dad or granddaddy or great-granddaddy. No, no, no. We get our own vision, our own covenant, our own relationship, our own connection to God. That's why just coming and being religious isn't going to do it, sitting in the family pew. We don't even have pews, God bless you. You could fit, sit in the family row, I guess, on our padded seats. But that's not going to get you anywhere. God said, I don't want you to go down to Egypt. I don't want you to do what your dad did. I want you to listen to me. How many here tonight, if you know there's a blessing in it, if you're really convinced there's a blessing, you got enough faith in God to know that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him, and he's a blesser. How many tonight would say, you know what, I think I could do what God told me to do. Come on, how many can say, that's me, I can do that. Now, it's not easy to always do everything that God calls us to do. It takes faith, it takes diligence, but look, that's what God's looking for. Abraham had the same situation, but God was saying, I want you to do it my way, not your dad's way. Let me say that again. God wants us to do it his way, not the way our parents or our grandparents or our Uncle Ned or Aunt Minnie or the neighbors or the mayor or somebody in our school. No, no. What they're doing, they got to answer to God for that. What God's looking for us to do is respond to his direction for us. There's a unique journey that God has planned for you. Don't try to just do the boring same old, same old. Establish your purposes in your own heart. How do you do that, Randy? By getting in contact with God. And you'll notice God came to him. God revealed himself to Isaac. Did you notice that? Now, maybe Isaac was asking for that revelation. Maybe, I don't know. But I know that God is willing and able to communicate with his people. God is willing and able to communicate even with somebody who's far away from him. If you'll just cry out and say, Lord Jesus, come on into my life. He can make himself very, very apparent. He can make himself very, very real. I know he did that for this guy when I was a teenager. I said, if there's a God up there, please show me. And boy, did he show me. Oh, boy. And it was a fun ride and a wild ride at the same time. Some people here tonight, you've got to establish that covenant for yourself. So God, he says, I'm going to confirm the offer of a covenant with you. And he says the same covenant that he's told Abraham, his father. He said that your father served me, your father obeyed me, I made a covenant with him, I'm making the same covenant with you if you'll do what I say. If you do what I say. And you'll notice God always makes promises. Promises, promises, promises. Come on, think about that for a minute. I'm just going to ask this. Has anybody here ever received an answer for a request you made to God based on a promise that he gave you, either through his word or in the spirit? Has anybody besides me, if you have, slip your hand up. I want to see how many people can say, yeah, God's met needs in my life, and he did it based on a promise. You know, the rainbow in the sky is based on a promise. The things that he makes in the New Testament, the new covenant, are a promise. Promises, I was thinking about this. Promises are the fuel of excellent relationships. I mean, Lisa and I got married August 25th, 1971. That was a long time ago, but not that long. I still remember it very vividly. And when he stood before the minister of the gospel, he asked us to make some promises. And we've endeavored the best we can to keep those promises, because any healthy, blessed relationship is going to be predicated on promises. If you have a business and you got a partner in your business, you're going to make certain promises with one another. Sometimes they're formalized in a document, there's an agreement, contract of some sort. People make promises. When I was on the road all the time, constantly traveling, still do some, but not as much. But I made a promise to be so-and-so and such on a certain date at a certain time. Do a sound check, do some music, minister the gospel, encourage the people of God, wherever it was, whatever I was doing. It was based on promises. Almost everything that we do is a promise. I don't know about you, but I'm a little suspicious of organic food in the supermarket. Come on. I don't know for sure if it's actually organic. You know, they say organic and they charge you a little more to make you believe it. But I'm wondering if it really is. I've read different articles say, absolutely, get organic food. Some people say, no, don't worry about it because it's a fraud, it's a sham. You know what? I'm not sure, but I do try to buy it pretty regular, just hoping that it's okay. But the promise that it's organic is only as good as the people making the promise. The relationship that we have is only good as the person backing up the promise. If I got a rotten wife, which I don't, thank you, Jesus. She's only going to be as good as her character and her commitment to the promise. Same goes for me. Is anybody getting this? So God's a God of covenant. You say, well, it's so strange. I mean, what God doing? Is he doing some kind of a business transaction? No. Love, true love is based on promises. I don't know if anybody, I'm trying to make sure this is landing. Because, see, this is pivotal. People, they paint God as some, you know, he's demanding this, demanding that. If you do this, then I'll do that. No, no. Everything in life is that way. That's the texture and the fabric of the universe. We've got to be able to be confident if somebody says the chair you're sitting on will hold you up, that their character is good enough to back that up so I don't fall on my tushy on the floor. Can we erase that out of the recording for the internet? Tushy? I don't know. I don't know if that's very spiritual. Come on, how many know what I'm saying? In our lives, that's the way we got to live. Christians understand it above all. And when God comes to Isaac, he establishes a covenant with him, and it's based on promises. And those promises matter big time. They matter in business. They matter in marriage. They matter in ministry. I know people that made promises in the context of a Christian ministry and got ripped off. Sometimes promises don't last very long because the people who make them aren't worth the paper it's written on, or the heart that they show is a fraud and they don't follow through. This is true throughout the world. And I say Christians ought to stand up and believe God and have character that represents the honesty of the kingdom and just absolutely live backing our promises all the way. If we make a promise, then do it in the name of Jesus. If you make a vow, keep the vow. If you say, Jesus, I need you and love you, then stay with that program. It doesn't mean you'll do everything perfectly. I always put that caveat on things because, look, we're going to find out here that nobody's perfect. As a matter of fact, the next thing we find in the story is Isaac lies about his wife. Talk about promises. I'm going to hold you near. I'm going to be with you in sickness and health. I'm going to be there for you, honey. He stands before the priest, you know, makes the commitment, makes the promises, makes the promises. The first time he feels a little bit of fear and he's afraid for his life, he says, I don't know who she is. Oh, that's my sister. Remember mom and dad? Yeah, hey, how you doing? Come on. Isaac lies about his wife. We read the story, right? He lies about his wife. And I wrote down a question in my notes. Did you ever look in the mirror and see dad staring back? Did you ever look in the mirror and see mom staring back? Yes. The whole dad thing's been happening to me a lot lately. Especially when I'm really worked up, because my dad was a high-strung kind of guy. My dad didn't need caffeine to get his energy up. You probably couldn't tell that by me, but anyhow, I got some of his DNA. And you know what I'm saying? And Isaac did the same thing his father did. Abraham, when the famine came, went down to Egypt. He had a beautiful wife too. And Abraham lied, said, she's my sister, the same way Isaac did. I don't think it's a coincidence that their lives follow the same pattern, because every one of us has famines in our lives. Every one of us reacts to those famines. Every one of us deals with these kinds of issues, and fears rise up. And the Bible said in the scripture we read, I was afraid for my life, and so I lied. Wow. So here again, you can follow your DNA if you want. Sometimes it'll be good. Sometimes it's going to be lousy. You can follow societal influences. What's everybody else doing? I want the young people to hear me. I don't care if everybody in the world's doing it. That doesn't mean God wants you to do it. I don't care if there's 20 million people doing it. That doesn't mean you have to do it. And that applies to all of us, all the way up to people like me, the oldsters in the house. Come on, someone. You don't have to obey those things. And yet Isaac got caught in the same snare that his father did. It's so easy to be influenced by our family, even by peers. And we end up doing stuff, you know, in a way that's not genuine, not authentic, not ethical, not honest. We all have those moments. Let's not look down our nose at Isaac. Too harsh. Because the Bible teaches us plainly that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It wasn't just Isaac. It wasn't just Abraham. Every one of us needs the grace of God. Everybody say, I pray. Come on, everybody say, I pray for the grace of God in my life. Because we need that. All these things will cause us to shift into a certain mode. We got to be aware of it. And you'll notice the motivation was fear. A lot of times we end up in these very unethical, lying, dishonest, living a fraud. Why? Because a lot of times it's a fear thing. Fear starts to dominate us. And you'll notice how it reveals itself. Fear often reveals itself in selfishness. Selfishness. He was worried about himself. He didn't care that he put his wife in danger. Come on. He wasn't thinking that he was putting all the men and the people of that land in danger. Isn't Abimelech, wasn't he clear when he said, somebody would have possibly slept with her, and we would have been guilty of a great sin. Even a pagan like Abimelech realized that adultery and fornication is a great sin. He wasn't even following God. Everybody knows that God's called us to a higher standard and wants our lives to be more pure and blessed. He wants us to live the best life we can. And that doesn't include those kinds of things. And yet the selfishness in him said, I don't care about those people, and I don't care even about my wife. I care about myself. I'm afraid they're going to wipe me out in order to take her. Selfishness is a dangerous thing. But I want you to notice the truth is revealed. The truth is revealed. The Bible says the truth's going to be revealed. Be sure your sin will find you out. And so we've got to take it seriously. And it came out. He looked out the window, the king did. Saw him over there sporting, I think it says in the King James. Whatever sporting is, I don't want to go into all that. But one translation says caressing, this one. Some say joking, laughing. But he saw that it was definitely not his sister. And boy, he called him on the carpet right now. Can anybody see that? Is that plain in the story? And you know what? We got to remember, all of us are in the same boat one way or another. We've all fallen short of the standard. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. We've all fallen short of the holiness of God. We all have sinned. I quoted it, Romans. And fallen short of that great glory of God. We've all done it. But then I love the other verse. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Oh, wow. So you mean God can save imperfect people? Hello. We're all imperfect. If you're standing in the righteousness of God tonight, it's because of his grace, not your abilities. You mean God can use people like that? Absolutely, God can use them. And so here we have this guy lying, deceiving the leader of the Philistines, the king, you could call him, deceiving all these people, putting everybody in danger. But the truth is revealed. And somehow, when he confesses that to Abimelech, he says, you know what, I was afraid, and I did. And I can't help but think that he didn't say, you know what, I blew it, I'm sorry. And then the king made a proclamation. Nobody touched these people. He took away the possibility of punitive damage or retribution. He took away the possibility of death. Because the truth was revealed. See, when the truth comes, it pushes away death. When the truth is revealed, people are set free. That's why Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. If you're looking for freedom in your soul, if you're looking for blessings in your life, you've got to get in contact with the truth. And so I want to finish with just a couple of final thoughts. I'm going to say this. When you read verse 12, it's almost like boom. Here comes the blessing. He gets done with the soap opera. The next verse, he plants some seeds in that same year. This wasn't after he had some kind of restoration or went to some kind of a hospital and got, you know, some sort of treatments. It wasn't any kind of special counseling or anything else. He just recognized the truth. He admitted the truth. He confessed the truth. And then he planted the seeds and got a hundredfold blessing back just like that. Randy, you mean to tell me God can bless those kind of imperfect people? Well, boy, I'm a testimony to that. In my life, and I've certainly not been perfect, I've received great blessings from the Lord. Is there anybody else here tonight that recognizes you haven't been perfect? You're still not perfect, but you've been blessed of God. We've got to confess the blessing is resting upon us. Don't let the devil lie to you. The devil will come. He's called the accuser of the brothers. He's the accuser of the sisters. He'll tell you, well, you know what? You'd be blessed if you didn't blow it last Wednesday. You'd be blessed if you didn't, you know, you did that little thing with the parking meter. You'd be blessed if you wouldn't have run out of gas, if you would have just been nice to the, you missed it, you fouled up, you lied to somebody. See, the devil, every little thing you do, the devil's going to come back and he's going to try to intimidate with you and he's going to try to handicap you. He's going to try to take your legs out from under you. And so I say to, boy, God, can you use me? My imperfections, the things that sometimes I mess up. The Bible says if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us and grant righteousness to us. Doesn't the Bible say that? Well, why does it say that? Because God realizes, even if you're on your best trajectory with the Holy Ghost, you're probably going to mess up a few times. Hopefully it's not constantly, every hour or every 10 minutes. But God's looking for imperfect people that he can use so his glory will shine even brighter. And so guess what? The whole human race qualifies. And so do you and I. And that should be good news to everybody. You talk about the gospel, that ought to be good news, that God's grace can be resting upon every one of us, and that God can use you, he can use your neighbor, he can use imperfect people. Now, he wants us to strive for perfection. He wants us to walk in perfection by faith. This is not a license to sin. Oh, Pastor Randy said, well, he's going to use imperfect people, so I'll be really imperfect. Let me see if I can find a half a dozen sins I can do before the night's out. No. The Bible says, should we sin so that grace will abound or be more and more? No, God forbid, it says in Romans. No, you resist sin. But you're also not going to be condemned when you make a mistake if you're willing to say, you know, Lord, I blew it. And I like to point out, Jesus, they asked Jesus, how many times should I forgive my neighbor? Because the law said seven times. And Jesus said an amazing thing. He says, no, you should forgive him 70 times seven. Now, let me ask you this. If God expects us to forgive people that many times, and that's a way of saying just keep the forgiveness coming, how many times do you think he's going to forgive you, even if you blow it a few times? Maybe many times. Maybe you drop the ball. Maybe you do something wrong. You think God's just going to dispatch you just like that? The Bible says the love of the Lord is long. His patience endures forever. He's long-suffering. He'll suffer with us a long time, waiting for us to get our life back in kilter. You might be away from the Lord tonight. I'm not standing up here to condemn you. I'm telling you, God uses imperfect people, but he makes you perfect through the blood of Jesus. How many are hearing what I'm saying? And so let me just say this. I started thinking about it. Does God use imperfect people? How about Abraham? He got a promise that God would give him a son, Isaac. But Sarah and Abraham got nervous. They jump-started the prophecy. They jump-started the covenant. And he went into his maidservant, Hagar, at his wife's encouragement, and had a little baby called Ishmael. I don't know if anybody here ever birthed an Ishmael, but it can happen in more ways than one. It's not just about birthing. It's about bringing something into your life that God didn't intend. And you know what? Ishmael is the father of the Arab people. And they've had wars and strife and all that for all these centuries of the Jews and the Arabs and all this. This has been going on. Why? Well, because they jump-started They jump-started God's promise. They tried to do it in their own strength. Jacob, same way. Jacob was a supplanter. He was a liar. He was a con artist. The son of Isaac was a con artist. And he worked and worked and worked through his life to try to get this and get that. And because of the covenant that was resting on his family, he had some level of success, but he had a lot of defeats too. And ultimately, he had to wrestle with the Lord, wrestle with the angel, in order to get a hold of his own version of the covenant. Wasn't enough to live on granddaddy's or even his father's. He had to have one. How about Jonah? The wrong way prophet. God tells him to go down to Nineveh and prophesy. And he gets all freaked out. He gets all nervous. He gets all shook up. And he gets in a boat and goes directly the opposite direction and runs away. We all know the story of Jonah. How many think Jonah was a perfect prophet? Oh, I don't see any hands. I mean, eventually he was. Eventually, once he got vomited up by the big fish. But he wasn't a perfect prophet. God uses imperfect people. Congratulations. Look at this verse, one of my favorite verses in all the Bible. Look. And what does it say? The word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time. Because he blew it the first time. So you think God's going to give you a second chance? Come on, everybody say, oh yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes, he is. And more than that. Because he's love. Now, his spirit will not always strive with man. Sooner or later, come on, go and pull the plug. But there is such a thing called grace, which means the unmerited favor. You don't deserve it, but God blesses you anyhow. He's with you. He helps you. He'll work with you even when you mess up. He's going to try to get you where you need to be, and then he can open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. Think about David, the great king, who was an adulterer. He lived a life of deception. He committed murder. And yet God ultimately blessed him because in the 51st Psalm, he said, God, I repent before you. Remove not your Holy Spirit from me. And he repented of what he had done. Ezekiel was depressed. The man practically was a walking, depression bomb going off all the time. He was afraid of the prophets who had been killed. He was afraid of the king and the queen. And he ran and he hid out and he was a mess. And yet we have a whole book in the Bible devoted to his writings. Think about Thomas, doubting Thomas. He's the guy who wouldn't believe Jesus was raised from the dead unless he touched his body, touched his wounds. And yet he's the guy who was one of the great apostles of the church. He was the guy that went in and evangelized India. In certain parts of India, he is revered. They have statues of Thomas who brought Christianity to India. Here's this doubting Thomas. How many would say he was a perfect apostle? There is no such thing. I will go so far as to say there's no, outside of God's grace, there's no perfect Christian. In your own abilities, you cannot do it. But in God's grace, in his abilities, yes, he'll give you power. And you should be going from grace to grace, faith to faith, stronger and stronger. Solider and solider. Why? Because he's faithful. It's him. It's him. It's him. And how about Peter? Peter fails multiple times. If anybody had foot and mouth disease, Peter had foot and mouth disease. How many remember when he cut the guy's ear off? Peter was constantly making mistakes. Then he denies Jesus, and then he follows it up with a chaser of profanity. Would you say he was a perfect leader for the church? Not in our eyes, but who was the guy that God chose and anointed to stand up on the day of Pentecost, the birthday of the church, and preach a sermon where 3,000 men plus women and children came to Jesus? I'd say that's a revival meeting if I ever saw one. And it was an imperfect man that God used. Some of you need to hear this. God loves to bless imperfect people. Not that you can go out and just wantonly sin. No, 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 no. But on your best day, I would say a good bit of the time, you're not going to do what you're supposed to do perfectly. And so we celebrate his love for us in grace. And we certainly strive against sin. Hebrews says, you have not yet resisted sin unto blood. He says, so there's no, we're not giving any quarter to sin. I don't want to sin. Sin hurts. Sin's rotten. Sin smells. But if you come through a moment where you fail, don't let Satan come along and condemn you. Just say, Lord, I come to you as your servant. I ask you to forgive me of my falterings, my faults, my sins, my picadillos, the things that I've done wrong. God, I come to you and ask you for forgiveness. And you know what God does? Just like that. He imputes righteousness. And in our sight, we may not look perfect, but in God the Father's sight, when he looks at you, he sees the blood of Jesus, and you look absolutely perfect. So did God use Isaac? Absolutely. Was Isaac perfect? No. Did he get blessed abundantly? Oh, absolutely. But God used him nevertheless. Such an amazing way. So Isaac's season of blessing is a picture of God's intention and heart for you and for me. That's really what it is.